ya, how can I start learning? Bagaimana saya mau belajar? Teman aja saya nggak bisa ketemu gitu. Kuota saya nggak punya. Nah, kalau kuota mah harus ya ada bantuan pemerintah lagi, masa nggak bisa dimanfaatkan gitu. Okay, so there is a quotation from someone there. Yeah. Want to play piano? Find a practice website, get a piano or keyboard and start playing. Want to learn how to jog properly? Study some exercise videos and put on the running shoes. You'll make the plenty of mistakes as you learn and practice, sure, but you'll gain invaluable experience too. Jadi katanya kalau kamu mau pintar piano, ya silahkan belajar, cari website ini, pengajaran-pengajaran ini. Kamu practice sendiri. Ya mungkin salah, tapi kesalahan yang kamu lakukan itu akan menjadi sesuatu yang sangat penting untuk perkembangan kamu. Begitupun juga dengan pembelajaran bahasa. When you start speaking English to everyone around you, maybe you make mistakes, but it's okay. At least there is a valuable things inside your practice. Yeah. Okay. So first, that we have to adjust this problem, because we are in pandemic era. One solution is we have to use social media. Okay, because the internet gives us a chance to use it. Yeah, to use it wisely. Wisely, ya, dengan bijak. Artinya gunakan dengan sesuatu yang sangat berguna untuk kamu dan untuk orang-orang sekitarmu. Seperti itu. Okay, so next, I don't know exactly why this paused. Okay, so let's get started. Okay, according to Greenhouse and Chapman, 2020, yeah. Social distancing made social media digital tools for connecting students, teachers, and citizens in an emergency. So lucky us, because we have social media. So many teachers and students actually communicate by using social media and utilize those social media to make the learning process. So let us see what are the medias. First is Learn English with Echo. Yeah, this application helps learners with reading, writing, listening, speaking, conversation, learning pronunciation, translation, grammar, and vocabulary. Unfortunately, I cannot explain you well about this. Why? Because it's many. It takes time. I just give you the title of the application, so maybe you can practice it and you can download it for free, yeah, later, and you can learn it by your own self. Jadi ada juga Learning English with Busuu, yeah. Learn to Speak English with Busuu is an application of social media which contains many features. So you can choose which country that you want to explore, and then you can learn the language from the basic one. Hello English, this is especially if you want to focus on speaking. Yeah, it is actually valuable and very useful for everyone. So you can practice your English, and then this is very interactive and interactive and creative application. Then we have also HelloTalk. This is the application connect language learners directly to native speakers. I think it's very useful, because why? We need feedback. Somehow, people think that when they practice English, it's enough. Yeah, if there is no feedback, it's enough. But I thought that if you have a feedback, you will see your weakness, and then you can revise it, and it can make it better, right? Jadi HelloTalk ini sangat berguna. Kenapa? Karena bisa ngomong sama native speaker aslinya gitu, dan itu sangat bagus. Bisa kita bisa tahu vocabularisnya secara tepat, konteksnya tepat, culture-nya tepat, dan oh, kalau saya ngomong ini ternyata nggak baik nih kalau di sini. Oh, kalau saya ngomong seperti ini ternyata pronunciation-nya seperti ini. So it is very useful. Then there is also BBC Learning English. Yeah, you can for free, and then you can listen to those programs, many basic programs also there provide English grammar, English speaking, and also the vocabularies. So it is okay for you if you want to start from the beginning. Yeah, actually BBC Learning English also provides that. And then memories, it is also related to vocabularies. So it can enhance your vocabularies. It is also, it also looks like Duolingo. Yeah, so you can start from the basic one. So this application actually tries to figure out your competencies and your level, and then you can learn the new vocabularies based on the applications given to you. So this one is Duolingo, provides level of vocabularies. Lucky us, there is also Duolingo test. And then now on, this Duolingo test is used for English English takers. Yeah, English test takers. Why? It is actually replaced some. It is not, but it is not all, but some English proficiency test like TOEFL and IELTS. Duolingo ini adalah salah satu aplikasi yang sekarang mempunyai tes yang bisa untuk pada saat pandemi ini ya mengganti posisi beberapa EPT seperti TOEFL, IELTS, ya, dan harganya sangat 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 masih kadar wajar lah, masih bawah dibanding IELTS. Saya rasa kalian bisa coba belajar deh ini karena tesnya itu sama dengan praktisnya. Saya pernah mengambil tes ini dua kali, ya. Tesnya ini sama dengan praktisnya. So this application wants to see the level of vocabularies. And the last one is Rosetta Stone. This application provides simple English samples. So actually, it is used by children, kids. But it doesn't mean that if you are adult, you cannot learn this. Because maybe your language skill is still low, you can start from this one. Then you can also utilize the popular social medias to demonstrate your speaking skill and to find friends to communicate with. Jadi kalian bisa panggil tuh, gunakan apa sih social media yang kalian sering gunakan selama ini? Facebook, Instagram, TikTok, Telegram, WhatsApp, ya. Kenapa, why don't you collect your friends that have same vibes with you? Kenapa tidak cari teman yang sama itu, yang punya motivasi yang sama? Ataukah cari orang dari luar negeri untuk komunikasi? Atau cari buku-buku yang bisa berguna dalam perkembangan language kalian? Ya, kalau misalnya berhubungan dengan speaking, it's very good to practice it by using those social medias. For example, TikTok. Kalau kalian, you can post, you can upload your video, like a voice over video, ya, bisa kalian upload dan bisa menjadi patokan buat kamu bahwa oh, this one is my level, and you can also find comments from your followers and from the viewers. Okay, so let us see again. How do I practice without internet connection? It's very hard. Okay, so let us know that I think if you don't have internet connection, if even though this is actually impossible, but if it's possible, how do I practice without internet connection? So you can imitate something. So if you cannot use your computer, yeah, you can use the book, and then you can explore the language. Like you can see the picture here. When I was young, the person starts from the basic one. Jadi yang paling dasar. When I was young, I blah blah blah. Kemudian dia kembangkan, ganti. When he was young, he. So the person changed the subject. And then it is it develops into when he was young, so he, now he, ya. Jadi berbeda langsung, tesisnya lagi berbeda. Jadi sehingga perkembangan bahasanya itu lebih berbeda. So we don't only focus on the speaking, we also can develop our grammatical knowledge, yeah. And also you can also practice with your friends in front of by using WhatsApp, and also you can practice in front of the mirror. Unfortunately, if you practice in front of the mirror, there is no feedback. Rather than in Cushion say that we need I input and plus N new. Ya, jadi kalau terlalu susah itu nggak bisa masuk. Tapi kalau terlalu dasar nggak ada feedback itu juga nggak berkembang. So we need feedback at least one level ya above. Okay, so remember, output reflects your input. Speaking is a productive skill. It needs other skill to strengthen its capacity. Artinya gini, kalau kita mau memberikan sesuatu yang baik, maka kita harus mempunyai input yang baik. Nah, skill ini itu sangat related to other skills. Jadi kalau kita mau expert di speaking, paling tidak kita membaca banyak vocabularies, kita mendengar, oh kalau vocabularies ini konteksnya bagusnya seperti ini. Kita bisa menuangkan vocabularies tersebut dalam tulisan, sehingga ini sangat related. You have to know exactly this is a productive skill. Jadi kita receive something and you can produce something. Okay? Then, okay, so there are two aspects that need attention here for the English learner, according to BAU 2013. First is reflection of learner identity. So you have to know your own level, and then when you learn, do you think that you have got the input, or you have at your level by learning or by doing or practicing your speaking process? It is very good to revise your mistakes and also to cope your weakness. Ya, paling bagus adalah kita merefleksi. Jangan langsung jojong aja seperti itu. Harus ditahu, oh kalau saya ngomong seperti ini, oh ternyata gini. Ada refleksi. Oh ternyata vocabulary saya sudah sampai di sini. Oh ternyata fluency saya seperti ini. So you have to know it exactly. Yeah. Again, you have to see the CEFR level there. You can check it. Yeah. You can find it in internet, and then you can recheck your competencies later. And the second one is cultural localization of materials. Jadi kita juga harus tahu budaya atau konteks dari bahasa tersebut. If I talk this, it is good if it's suitable, and then how I adopt the language in my culture, how I adjust if it's different meanings. So you have to know exactly about that. Why? Because talking about speaking, we also talks about culture. Okay, thank you. I do hope you can understand my presentation. And you know, the process in listening to this webinar is also a step to get closer with the knowledge. Yeah, I do hope you can. We can discuss it more later in the discussion part. And then I will give it back to the moderator. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Okay, thank you for Ms. Fitroh Aulia Ansor for your nice explanation. And now we come to our second presenter, that is Ms. Nunun Indrasari, MPD. For Ms. Nunun, we please you to deliver your explanation. Oh, before that, yeah, here is the curriculum vitae of Ms. Nunun. Sorry, I forget to read it. Ya, nama lengkap Nunun Indrasari, MPD, jenis kelamin perempuan, tempat tanggal lahir Temanggung, 27 Juli 1987, agama Islam, status menikah, alamat perumahan Pujangga Alam Garden, Blok K1 nomor 5 Jalan Nusantara, Labuhan Ratu, Bandar Lampung. Nomor telepon 0856-4311-9093. Email nununindrasari@radenintan.ac.id. Pendidikan formal 1994 sampai tahun 2000 di SD Negeri Jampi Roso 2, Temanggung, Jawa Tengah. 2000 sampai 2003 SLTP Negeri 2, Temanggung, Jawa Tengah. Tahun 2003 sampai 2006 SMA Negeri 1, Magelang, Jawa Tengah. Tahun 2006 sampai 2010 S1 Pendidikan Bahasa Inggris Universitas 11 Maret Surakarta. Tahun 2011 sampai 2012 S2 Pendidikan Bahasa Inggris Universitas 11 Maret Surakarta. Pengalaman kerja guru bahasa Inggris di SMP Negeri 2 Temanggung 2010, dosen bahasa Inggris di STIKES Harapan Bangsa tahun 2012 sampai 2013, dosen bahasa Inggris di Universitas Bandar Lampung tahun 2014, dosen bahasa Inggris di IAIN Raden Intan Lampung tahun 2015 sampai sekarang. Yaitu kurikulum vitae of Miss Nunun Indrasari. And for Ms. Nunun, we please you to deliver your explanation.
Okay, thank you, Mbak Silva. Well, I'm starting to share my screen first. Is my voice clear?
Yeah, it's clear.
Okay. Can you see my screen?
Sure.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Yeah, it's really pleased to be here with you all today in this webinar with Rumah Baca Madinah. Thank you so much, Pak Muhdinitur and Bu Suatun for the chance given to us. And as the second speaker, I'd like to talk to you about the next skill. It's about listening skill. Yeah, so this is my presentation. Choose what you listen and do it comfortably. Well, before we go further about listening skill, I'd like to talk a little bit about learning languages. If you can see, if you can see two pictures here, there are a picture of parts of car engine, and the other picture is the people who is practicing how to drive a car. This is the same when we are learning language. It's necessary for us to know, to learn grammar, vocabulary, and other components of language. It's necessary for us to know parts of car, parts of engine in the car, but we also have to learn how to learn how the grammar and vocabulary go together, make communicative messages. So if we want to learn how to drive a car, it is not enough if we just know about part of car or part of the engine. So that's why we also have to practice how to drive a car, how to use the pedal, how to use the, coupling dan sebagainya to make it work together, and then the car can go smoothly. Begitu juga dengan learning languages. We have to learn how the grammar, the vocabulary, and also other components go together to make communicative messages. So how to learn that? Yeah. The best way, one of the best way to do that is to listen to the language that you understand. Yeah, as we know that listening is different with hearing. Hearing is just the physiological process. It means that you receive the sound waves from outside of the body, but there's no, active process in your brain. But listening means that you have to activate your brain to know what is the speaker meaning, to understand what does the speaker says. So how is L2 listening learn? How can we learn English listening? There are two ways that we can do here. The first one is intensively, and then the second one is extensively. Intensively means that we just focus more on the form, the components of the language, for example, the pronunciation, focuses only the grammar and or vocabulary, then overall meaning. But in extensive listening, it focuses on input that is comprehensible and enjoyable. So in extensive listening here, the learner should experiment listening activities with lots of input which is comprehensible and enjoyable. Okay, further, I'd like to talk about some principles of extensive listening. So in extensive listening means that we give exposure input to the learner. The input should be meaningful. We know that internet nowadays is very cool. There are lots of listening materials, but we also have to be able to choose which one is meaningful for us, which one is beneficial for us. And then the second principle is comprehensible, dapat dipahami. So make sure that you learn something, that you listen something. For example, you listen to the audio or you watch the video from YouTube or from any other sources, you comprehend the content of the video. You understand what the video says to you. That's the point of extensive listening. If you listen but you do not understand all of the content of the video, it cannot be said as extensive listening. And then the third principle, that which is also important, is enjoyable. In extensive listening, the students or the learner is expected to do it enjoyably, dengan sukarela. Jadi tidak ada paksaan. Yeah, so there are these are three important principles that we have to know when we want to do extensive listening. Okay, regarding to those principles, so how do we select EL materials? EL here means extensive listening. Bagaimana kita memilih materi extensive listening untuk kita? Well, the materials in extensive listening, the qualified materials in extensive listening is depending on the level of the student's comprehension. Jadi, the materials, for example, these materials may be suitable for one learner, but maybe it is not suitable for the other learners because the level of the comprehension is different. So if we want to select extensive listening materials, we have to know the level of difficulties of the materials. So listening materials in extensive listening should be pitched at the right level. Jadi kita bisa melakukan dengan mencoba. Find the listening materials and then we try to listen it. If we can understand most of the content of that listening materials, so maybe that's your level of listening comprehension. But if you are really hard to understand, so maybe this is not your level. You can find another listening material which is lower than that. And listening materials can be authentic and simplified materials. Authentic materials means that the materials is usually used in daily life. For example, TV, a movie. But simplified materials is the material that is designed to be learned, that is designed to be a source of learning. Yeah, so you can choose whether you want to find out the authentic one or the simplified one. And then the next is content, isinya. The content should should contain the language features that can engage students' attention. Tadi seperti principle yang sudah dijelaskan di awal, yaitu meaningful input. Input is very crucial in literature, but not all input is meaningful. Not all input is comprehensible. So it depends on the learners to find the meaningful input for them. And then the next is enjoyable. You can find the materials that meet your interests, that you like, the topic that you like. For example, you like sport, you can find the video about sport. Or if you like cooking, maybe you can find the YouTube video about cooking tutorial or something. Yeah. And then, okay, this is these are some online sources that you can use to hone your listening skills. The first one is Storyline Online. Here, this website provides lots of children's stories, which is read by the professional artists. Jadi ini adalah beberapa kumpulan beberapa it's like audiobook ya, yang dibacakan oleh orang yang berpengalaman. So the pronunciation is quite clear and easy to understand. And there is also English Central. Ini juga provides some short videos that you can use to be your listening materials. Then ada juga British podcast, ya, British podcast itu ada categorized, ada kategorinya. It is categorized as A1 and B1 if I'm not mistaken. Jadi ada levelnya, so you can choose based on your own level of comprehension. And then the next one is TED-ED. Yeah, TED-ED ini juga learning listening, because yeah, the video is quite good. The content of the video is quite good. And then ELLLO, it is also the website that provides lots of listening materials that you can access based on the category and the topic, if I'm not mistaken. So you can browse. There are lots of listening materials outside there. Yes, and if you like cartoon, for example, you can't go wrong to do that. Ya, tidak ada salahnya kalian mencoba untuk mengikuti cerita yang ada di kartun. I recommend some good children cartoon like Peppa Pig. Yeah, I know this cartoon because my daughter likes this so much. Dan saya mengikutinya. And this story is really simple. And I think the narrator, jadi ada naratornya di situ ya. The narrator is trying to sometimes they he is trying to repeat the sentence with the what is it, the same pattern. Misalnya ada suatu episode di mana Peppa itu nama pig-nya pergi ke swimming pool, and then the narrator says that Peppa Pig is wearing her swimming costume, Daddy Pig is wearing his swimming costume, George itu adiknya, George is wearing his swimming costume, dan sebagainya. In that case, I see that the narrator is trying to what is it, mempertegas bahwa he and she atau laki-laki dan perempuan itu menggunakan pronouns yang berbeda, her dan his. And I think the simple ways very useful for the children or for the beginner level to learn language, to recognize the pattern of the sentence. And the pronunciation also really clear and what is it, easy to understand. Yeah, ini menggunakan British pronunciation. And ada juga Syarah, Syarah and Duck. It is also very good cartoon. It's a short cartoon, but it's it has what is it? Good story, and there is also a moral value, and also Thomas and Friends. Who know? Who don't know Thomas and Friends? It's very famous. Yeah. So if you like other English cartoon, just try to untuk mengikuti ceritanya, because it's really helpful to build your listening fluency. Well, the next one is about listening activities. So when you want to do listening activities, there are some choice that you can decide. The first one is listening only. Yeah, you can just find the audio in the internet or maybe in your cell phone. There are lots of application related to listening comprehension nowadays. You can listen without viewing the screen or without reading the transcript, for example, or you can listening while reading in the online sources. In the online sources, there are some websites that provides the transcript, not only the audio but also the transcript. It also it is also helpful for you if you want to learn listening by listening while reading the transcript. And then listening and viewing, it's simply you look at the video, maybe from TED-ED video or from YouTube video, you listen and view the screen. Or listening, reading, and viewing. You listen and also read the subtitles maybe, and also viewing the screen of the video. So you can choose which is the most comfortable for you. And then after that, to make it last longer, after you have listening activities, you can just make some diaries, or we call it as listening log. So listening log is a variation on a journal in which learners record listening experiences outside class. For example, listening to the movies and then TV shows or series, radio shows, and etc., and reflect them. So after you listen to the video or audio, it's better for you to make the listening log to record your listening experience and also to reflect. Yeah, and then this is the example of listening log. Actually, this is my students' work. So I asked my students to make listening log by using Padlet. Padlet is a what is it? The platform. It's like a digital wall, so that the students can post anything to their digital wall. They can post the video. They can post their the audio, or they can record their voice, and or picture or anything. They can post anything there. And what can be posted in your listening log? Here there are some ideas that you can do with your listening log. We call it as follow-up activities. So after you do listening activities, there is follow-up activities that follows after listening activities. Nah, beberapa bisa dilakukan dengan melakukan reflection. Misalnya, after you listen to certain videos, you can do reflection. For example, then was what, because what. So this what is it? The sentence can stimulate you to think, to reflect after you listen or after you watch the video. Or other activities, you can do mind mapping. Yeah, mind mapping. For example, you find a video from TED Talk or from any other website. And then while you are watching the video, you are making your own mind map. And then you can capture your mind map and then post to your listening log. Listening log tidak hanya bisa menggunakan Padlet, tetapi juga bisa menggunakan your social media, for example, your Instagram, your Facebook, or any other social media. The function is to record your listening experiences. Jadi biar tidak gampang hilang. You can what is it? Look at some days and then untuk mengukur juga seberapa progresnya yang saya dapat selama ini. And then the next activity is about the personal views, for example, the opinion about the video. Maybe this video makes me think that what. So you can arrange your writing and then post to your listening log, or you can create the story. For example, you choose to listen the what is it? Children's story. Post the children's stories. You can act as a writer. If I were the writer, so you can build your own story, and then maybe you can also summarizing. You can write the summary of the video or audio, or maybe you can record your voice. It's helpful. Record your voice is helpful to recognize the pronunciation, because listening and pronunciation has close relationship. If we know appropriate pronunciation, it can help us to decode the words that we hear. And then next, the next is tips for building listening fluency. Yeah, there are some tips that we can do to build listening fluency. What is listening fluency? Listening fluency is listening with normal speed and then with good accuracy and with minimal effort. Or your mother is talking to you and you are easily understand what she said. So it is listening fluency karena tidak perlu effort banyak untuk memahami apa yang dikatakan oleh your mother. So in English, there are some tips for building English listening fluency. The first one is input. The input should be massive. Inputnya harus banyak, jangan hanya 1-2. And then comprehensible, inputnya harus yang dapat dipahami. Kemudian inputnya yang enjoyable, that you like. And then noticing the language features that you listen. For example, you notice the tenses, you notice the subject verb agreement, the word choice, the word stress, the pronunciation, and etc. Jadi tidak hanya mendengarkan saja, but also notice. Oh, ini menggunakan gaya bahasa yang seperti ini. It's really helpful to build your listening fluency. Because sometimes one meaning can be delivered in many ways. Maknanya mungkin sama, tetapi gaya bahasa beberapa orang will be different. And if you notice that, it can improve your listening fluency. And then the next is frequency. Frequency, misalnya you can make the schedule. 1 week should listen two or three videos, two or three English videos. Or maybe you repeat listening. You do repeated listening. If you like English movie, you can do it. You can do repeated listening. For example, the first time you listen without any subtitles, and then the second one you watch again, you watch the movie again with the English subtitle, and then you watch the third time without English subtitle. seberapa improvekah progresnya. It's really helpful to build the listening fluency. And then the next one is social interaction. We know that learning language is to communication. It's to communicate, sorry. Belajar bahasa itu untuk communication, untuk berkomunikasi. So, tidak hanya mendengarkan saja, but I think it's useful to do social interaction. You can listen to the native and then respond. Yeah, respond what they say. Atau melakukan percakapan dengan orang menggunakan berbahasa Inggris. Yeah, so you do integrative skill. Yeah, jadi tidak hanya listening saja. And then the last one is motivation. Of course, before you decide to do extensive listening, first thing that you have to possess in your mind, in your heart, is motivation, because no motivation, no learning. Okay, so that's the tips. And I want to close this presentation with the quotation from Covey. It's the biggest communication problem is when we do not listen to understand, but we listen to reply. Okay, thank you very much. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Yeah, okay, thank you for Miss Nunun Indrasari MPD for your nice explanation. Okay, now we come to our third presenter, Mr. Muhammad Sayyid Wijaya, and here is the curriculum vitae of Mr. Muhammad Sayyid. Nama Muhammad Sayyid Wijaya, NIP 1988-0317-2015-03-1006, NIDN 2017-03-8801. Tempat tanggal lahir, Metro, 17 Maret 1988. Nomor KTP atau NIK, 1872-0417-0388-0003. Pangkat atau golongan, Penata 3C. Jabatan fungsional, Lektor, dosen pada prodi, Pendidikan Bahasa Inggris. Mata kuliah yang diampu, Reading for General and Academic Purposes. Mata kuliah lain, Language Testing and Educational Statistics. Alamat email, sayidwijaya@radenintan.ac.id, sayidwijaya@gmail.com. Nomor telepon, HP, 0852-7319-7781, dan 0857-4559-8008. RT R1905, Kelurahan Yosorejo, Kecamatan Metro Timur, Kota Metro, Lampung. Motto, the bitterest tears shed over graves are for words left unsaid and deeds left undone. Riwayat pendidikan, asal TK, Aisyah Metro, tanggal 11 Juni 1992, tanggal lulus 14 Juni 1994. Sekolah dasar Min 1 Metro, tahun lulus 2020. Asal SMP MTS Darussalam Tegineneng, tahun lulus 2003. SMA Man 1 Model Bandar Lampung, jurusan keagamaan, tahun lulus 2006. S1 Stain Jurai Siwo Metro, jurusan atau prodi Biah Pendidikan Bahasa Inggris, judul skripsi The Correlation Between Students' Prior Knowledge and Their Reading Comprehension Among the Second Semester Students of English Education Study Program at Stain Jurai Siwo Metro. Tahun lulus Desember 2010, nomor ijazah STI 13K PP 011-280-2011. Nama rektor Profesor Dr. Syarifuddin MAG. S2 Universitas Negeri Malang, Fakultas Pasca Sarjana, Jurusan atau Prodi Pendidikan Bahasa Inggris, judul tesis, The Effectiveness of the Reciprocal Teaching Method Towards Students' Reading Comprehension as Observed from Students with Different Learning Styles. Tahun lulus, Juni 2013, nomor ijazah 03177-UN32-6-S2-2013, Direktur Profesor Dr. I. Nyoman Sudana, Degeng, MPD. Okay, it was the curriculum vitae of Mr. Sayid. For Mr. Sayid, we please you to deliver your explanation.
Okay, thank you, Miss Sylvia of Rista. Now let me share my screen first. Okay. Oke, okay. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Today I would like to present you my ideas on extensive language skills, the joy of learning English. So I believe that reading would be an effortful activity for language learners since it demands them to concentrate on written information in the reading. So these conditions will make them as the language learners exhausted and suggest them to be unmotivated to read. In this case, being exhausted and unmotivated will lower their reading habit. But is that entirely true? Okay, now let me tell you Manara's story, okay, on her journal article. In her article, she narrated that she saw one of her students enjoying a book under an oak tree near the parking lot, okay, reading an Indonesian chiclet. So chiclet, if you are curious to know, a chiclet is a thin literature or modern fictions or pop fictions about lives and romantic problems. So that that students read this kind of literature written in Bahasa Indonesia or Indonesian language. So Manara was initially wrong, thinking that students had low reading habit at her class, at her reading class. After seeing that occurrence, that students enjoying a book under an old tree near the parking lot, she then realized that the student may have had high reading habit, since that students read outside the classroom with their own preferred reading texts, although it is written in Indonesian's language and genre. Then Manara managed to reflect her teaching practice on her reading course, which is commonly aimed at providing students with reading comprehension exercises. So if you are experiencing a reading course right now, you must be sure that all activity in reading course related to reading comprehension exercises. Commonly, your lecturer gave you a reading text, and then you are asked to answer the questions related to that text. Okay, that's the common activities found in reading courses. Okay. And then Manara noticed that she hardly tried to find out students' reading behavior, such as their favorable text types or their favorable topics. Afterward, she thought about extensive reading program, okay, as she remembered about it from the expert, which was regarded to motivate students to read more. So this extensive reading program is promoted to motivate students to read more, to arouse the sense of motivation from students to engage with the reading. It's good in actually to hear such a story, which makes us realize that knowing students' reading behavior is so important either for the teacher or for the students. Okay, however, how was that students' reading habit of English literature in Manara's story? That students may have had high reading habit of Indonesian's literature, but Manara unfortunately didn't tell us anything about that student's reading habit in English literature. Okay, Now, according to Jacob, she said that students may hesitate to read unless they find materials that interest them. Okay. That students in Manara's story may read English literature outside the classroom, if only that students found interesting materials, or that students may read the material inside the classroom, okay, if only the materials attracted that student's attention. So, in actually, all things will be interesting, and they will be attracted to the readers if the readers regard the topics or the content or materials of the readings interesting. If it is no, then the students may not be interested and will leave that kind of topic and do not put much effort on that readings. Okay. And actually, I conducted, so if the material uninterested, then the student will be unmotivated to read. And then I conducted a small group non-research-based survey. It is a survey, but it is a non-research-based one, by distributing an online questionnaire to some students, friends of mine, and colleges. They were asked to complete 5 incomplete statements by giving check boxes representing their choices. So the choices are magazine, short story, novel, tabloid, newspaper, or e-newspaper, journal article, and others. Okay, this is the first result of my non-based research or non-based survey. The first incomplete statement is I usually read. So I asked them to choose at least one, so they can choose more than one choices. The first incomplete statement is I usually read, as you can see in this chart. Most respondents usually read short story, novel, and journal article. And then the second incomplete statement, I enjoy reading. As you can see then, in this chart, most respondents usually read short story again, novel, and they enjoy reading them. So almost all respondents enjoy reading short story and novel, but it doesn't happen with journal article. So although that respondent usually read journal article, it seems that he does not enjoy reading journal article. Very interesting. And then the third incomplete statement is I could understand easily the content of. Okay, as you can see in the chart, most respondents could easily understand the content of short story, novel, magazine, newspaper, or e-newspaper, but not with journal article again and tabloid. Again, he who usually read journals articles seems not to enjoy reading that, okay, reading journal articles, and manage to understand its content. Although, some respondent read journal article, it seems that they do not enjoy it, and okay, that they couldn't really understand the content of that journal. And then the fourth incomplete statement is I could spend much time reading. So this chart is showing us that most respondents spend much time reading novel, of course, because commonly novel consists of more than 100 pages. So it takes time, followed by short story and journal article. Okay, very interesting. And the last incomplete statement is, I don't find difficulty in reading. So it can be seen that many respondents do not find difficulties in reading short story followed by novel and magazine. Okay. Now, from the spot incomplete statement, it can be inferred that most respondents usually read, enjoy, and understand easily short story. They also spend quite some time and find no difficulties in reading short story. So in this case, short story would be interesting materials for language learner, for us. If short story is the one we like to read, then how will we select a short story which meet our level? How do we find a short story which is suitable with our current proficiency or competency level? The answer is by having graded readers. So what is in actually graded readers? So graded readers are books, both fiction and non-fiction, in which the language in those books is controlled so that it matches the language competence of the learners reading the book. So this means that these books are designed based on language learners' competency level in general. It is like in CEFR, Common European Framework of Reference, which provide criteria what language learners at certain level should achieve. As the previous presenter explains or described in brief about CEFR, that in CEFR there are certain level like A1, A2, B1, B2, C1, and C2. Okay, in each level there are some criteria that a student need to fulfill before step up to the next level. Okay, it happen also with graded reader. And then these graded readers are aimed at motivating learners, help them gain reading fluency, enhance their vocabulary and grammar knowledge development. So these graded readers are not only designed to meet the level of the readers, but also to develop students or language learners competency in vocabulary also, grammar also, and for the external factor, it could be to motivate language learners. And okay, and here are the examples of graded readers. As you can see, the orange one, ELT graded reader, is labeled beginner. So this graded reader is suitable with readers at beginner's level. And the green one also, this is elementary A, so this fit with readers whose competency level or proficiency level at elementary A. And this one, the purple one, is upper intermediate level. So this graded reader fit with students in which her or his competency or proficiency level at upper intermediate level, okay? Okay, and they are graded, and this website provide a free online graded readers which can be read online. They serve their factual text or short story. So graded readers materials or contents do not only cover short story, but they serve us or provide us or provide reading materials on factual texts. Okay, and then so, unfortunately, there is considerable variations among publishers with regard to the way graded readers are categorized into level of difficulties, and the most common means of categorizations is the number of headwords. So, what is in actually headwords? Headword is a word or term place at the beginning as of a chapter or entry in an encyclopedia. So if you have dictionary and you see some bold words coming before the definitions, so they are called by headword. Like for example, you are going to find the word love in dictionary. Love commonly is written in bold before coming the definitions. So all the bold word in dictionary is called by headwords. Okay, like love, loves, loving. The headword is love. Loves and loving is the inflections. Okay, and another example is like in a noun phrase, a handsome gentleman. Okay, thank you. The word gentleman is the headword, followed or modified by handsome and followed by an article A. And it also happened in adverb phrase, for example, or adjective phrase. The head word would be adjective and or adverb. Okay, that's the example of head words. Okay, we can discuss this about head word later on. And then the leveling system of graded readers. Okay. Where is sec? Okay. So the leveling system of graded readers are based on head word, and commonly they inform how many head word there are in the books. So each books provide information about how many head words that book contains. Okay. But unfortunately, not all graded books provide that kind of information. If so, then how could we know the information about head word, and how could we know that this book would be appropriate to our current level of proficiency, of course, since each publisher provide different leveling system, although they commonly use head word as the basis to determine the leveling system. Okay. And we can use this kind of extensive reading foundations grading scale to find out whether the book or the graded readers fit in our proficiency or competency level. For instance, if we found that in that book there are 250 words or 250 head word, how could we know that book is appropriate or is suitable with what level of proficiency? Okay, if we see this, if we see this scale, 250, okay, is in high beginner. So we could say that book containing 250 head word are for those who are in high beginner level, or the book can be labeled as beginner or high beginner. So that's how to find out whether this book are fit in or are appropriate with our current level. Okay. Next. Okay, there is another way, and actually, whether the reading text fit in our level, it is called by Lexile framework for reading. Okay, so this Lexile framework for reading, which aim to match a reader's level with reading text of a suitable level, okay, is measured through reading comprehension tests, which the result is interpreted as a lexile as measure. So as Lexile measure. So to find out whether our current level fits with our current level, to find out our current level fit in the books, whether our current level is appropriate with the book level, we should have had a reading comprehension test. If we had such kind of test, the result of the test later on will be converted with this Lexile framework for reading. Okay. Unfortunately, this thing, this Lexile framework for reading, has been in critic, like what Krashen said. Okay. Krashen said. Krashen said in Gills and Furutaka, such system, Lexile framework, is unnecessary because readers can quickly determine whether a text is comprehensible and interesting by spending a few minutes sampling it for themselves. Jadi sebenarnya perlu nggak sih Lexile framework ini? Apakah perlu kalau misalnya kita tes reading dulu untuk menyesuaikan dengan level dari bukunya? The question is, bukan the questions ya, tapi it has been criticized in critic ya, dikritik sama si questions kalau misalnya Lexile framework is not really necessary. Jadi karena it will limit students reading selections. Jadi karena pakai Lexile framework ini akan membatasi pilihan dari bacaan siswanya nanti atau readersnya nanti. So it has been criticized by questions. Okay, and actually I'm on the same ship with Crescens. Jadi saya lumayan berpendapat dengan Crescens. Okay, so do we really need graded readers in actually? Yeah, I will certainly yes we do. Okay, but are we interested in the contents, materials, topic of those graded readers? Jadi kalau misalnya Crescensnya bilang it's okay, baca aja dulu sedikit, nanti kita baru tahu kira-kira ini sesuai dengan level kita atau tidak gitu. Jadi kalau misalnya ditanya lagi, kira-kira kita perlu nggak sih graded readers ini, buku yang di labelkan levelnya? If I say ya, it's certainly do. Ya perlu sekali untuk membaca buku yang satu yang punya level sama dengan kita. But it is apa ya? But it will be unnecessary to take the test just to match the book level. Jadi konsepnya ya nggak perlu aja kalau misalnya kita harus tes dulu supaya kita sama atau supaya kita tahu level buku apa yang perlu kita baca gitu kan. Hanya untuk mengetahui level buku apa saja yang kita baca. Because not all like proficiency test or competency test itu accessible for language learners. Jadi kalau misalnya if we want to find out our current level, whether our current level fit in with the book level, we just need to sample the readings, the content of that readings. Jadi kita hanya perlu untuk membaca sedikit bagian dari bukunya. If we find it difficult to understand, then we need to leave that readings. So I could assume like this one. So if the topic of the content of the reading is uninteresting, then the readers will not try to dig in and they may leave and find another topic. Yeah. If they find the topic interesting, yeah, then the content of the material are not the same level as their competency or proficiency level, they probably find them either too easy or too difficult, which will lead them to leave that interesting topics. Kalau topiknya ternyata menarik, tapi bacaannya nggak selevel dengan, nggak setingkat dengan kemampuan atau proficiency kita, ya it could be either too easy ataupun too difficult. Itu terlalu mudah, baik itu terlalu mudah atau terlalu sulit gitu kan? Ya it will lead them. It will lead them to leave that interesting topic. Jadi kalau terlalu mudah dan terlalu sulit itu ya readersnya nggak akan mau baca gitu kan. Ah ini terlalu mudah kayaknya jadi uninteresting. Yang tadinya interesting jadi uninteresting. Kalau too difficult itu sama saja. It could lead the readers to leave that interesting topic, yang interesting jadi tidak interesting. So the ideal one is to read the one you like and at your current competency level or proficiency level so that you will comprehend the readings or the text or the book easily. By having this kind of conditions, then you are going to be motivated to read another kind of interesting topic or interesting materials. Gitu. Oke, jadi kalau misalnya ideal conditions-nya ya harus baca buku yang menarik bagi kita, kemudian isi atau konten atau bahasanya itu sesuai dengan kemampuan kita, baru kita di situ akan lanjut untuk membacanya. Because reader will ignore any interesting topic if the language of the content of the material too difficult or too easy. Ya, jadi kok bahasanya terlalu sulit ya, they will find it hard to understand or comprehend the materials. Nah, itu akan membuat mereka jadi yang tidak menarik lagi. Okay. So, if you are interested in finding free short story website, you can check this website, but I recommend wattpad.com. Jadi kalau misalnya mau cari yang short story yang free, you can visit this website. Ada Wattpad. Wattpad itu penulisnya from any other region of the world, ya. Dari bagian dunia manapun itu ada di sana. Wattpad-nya it varies. Jadi beragam juga isinya mulai from the genre, dari genre-nya juga berbeda, jadi kalian bisa cek di website. If you can afford to buy original printed versions, kalian you can visit periplus.com or opentrolley.co.id. But I recommend periplus.com because I commonly buy novel at that website. The packaging is tremendously great. Okay, the price has been converted in rupiah. Jadi kalau ke periplus.com itu packagingnya bagus banget. Kemudian harga bukunya di periplus.com juga sudah di-convert ke dalam rupiah. Jadi semua bukunya kontennya berbahasa Inggris. If they do not have the stock, jadi kalau misalnya bukunya memang tidak tersedia di gudang Periplus-nya atau kalian mau pesennya dari luar negeri, itu biasanya 20 days ya, 20 working days delivery. Jadi akan sampai ke kita di dalam waktu 20 hari jam kerja ya. Atau misalnya sekitar 1 bulan. Saya pernah beli Toto Chan. Okay, this one. I bought this from periplus.com. Ini written in bahasa Inggris. Datangnya 21 bulan lah, sekitar 1 bulan kurang. Harganya cuma 150.000. So we only need to transfer to their bank account to buy the novel ataupun untuk beli buku yang disuka. You can visit periplus.com later on. Okay. We have free online courses. Jadi if you want to know your current proficiency or competency level, jadi kalau misalnya pengin tahu kompetensi levelnya di mana, you can visit British Council. Di sini ada linknya learningenglish.britishcouncil.org, if I'm not mistaken. You can visit this British Council, and this British Council will categorize the result of your test into beginner or pre-intermediate, intermediate, or upper intermediate and above. Okay. Nanti ketemu hasilnya dari British Council, jadi bisa masuk kategori apa setelah ikut tes, hasilnya nanti bisa dijelas. Nanti ada muncul tulisannya, kalian kira-kira setelah ikut tesnya masuk ke bagian yang beginner, okay, pre-intermediate, intermediate, or intermediate, atau above. Ya. Nanti itu di British Council tesnya itu muncul hasilnya. Kalau misalnya pengen tahu. Okay, but the best thing is, yeah, the best thing is you can sample the readings at your own. Yeah, if you want to know your, if you don't want to take the test, but you want to know from, you want to know your competency level from reading the sample of the novel or the short story. Jadi kalau misalnya mau pingin tahu kemampuan tanpa melakukan tes, ya silahkan saja dibaca sample dari teksnya. Kira-kira seperti itu. So, to conclude, yeah, to sum up in conclusions, if you want to find the joy of reading, you need to know the first one is what you like to read. The second one is your competency or proficiency level you are in. And the third one, what graded readers fit in you. So there are three things. Jadi ada tiga hal. Ya kalau misalnya mau menikmati apa namanya bacaan itu, ada tiga hal yang perlu kalian lakukan dulu. Kalian harus tahu what you like to read, yang mau kalian baca itu apa, bacaan yang kalian suka itu apa, topiknya itu tentang apa. Misalnya kalau short story ataupun novel, apakah itu apa namanya romantic one, apakah itu science fiction or any kind of genre. Kalau misal kalau sudah tahu apa yang mau dibaca, kemudian you need to know your competency level. Jadi tahu kemampuan saya itu di mana, kira-kira kalau saya baca buku yang menarik ini, saya bisa dengan mudah memahaminya enggak. Ya, kalau menikmati itu kan berarti we read it like a flow. Jadi kita bacanya itu yang mengalir aja. Jadi we could not there are no many like unknown words or difficult words ya. Jadi nggak banyak kata-kata yang sulitnya. Meskipun ada kita bisa skip tapi kita bisa comprehend isinya. Ya, itu kita harus tahu kompetensi levelnya. And the last one, what graded readers fit in you. Kita juga harus tahu buku yang mana yang pas untuk kita. Apakah buku itu sesuai dengan kompetensi kita atau tidak. So there are three things we need to know to enjoy readings. Oke, jadi itu adalah tiga hal yang perlu kita tahu supaya kita bisa menikmati membaca. Oke, so before closing my presentation today, I would like to read you a poem. Saya ada puisi sedikit yang akan saya bacakan.
Wow.
Are red, violets are blue, sugar is sweet, and so are you. Thank you. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Thanks to Mr. Sajid for delivering such a really nice explanation. And now we come to our last presenter, Ms. Nurul Puspita MPD. And here is the curriculum vitae of Ms. Nurul. Name Nurul Puspita MPD NIP 1989-07-17-20-15-08-2004 NIDN 0217-0789 Place or date of birth Sri Tejo Kencono 17 Juli 1989. Pangkat atau golongan Penata 3C. Jabatan fungsional Lektor Education S1 Pendidikan Bahasa Inggris UNILA, S2 Pendidikan Bahasa Inggris UNS. Okay. I am currently teaching at the English Department, Tarbiyah and Teacher Training Faculty, University, Islamic University, State Islamic University of Lampung for 5 years. I usually teach lesson planning and writing. I like to produce some journals of writing in collaboration with my hubby. We love to share each other. Fortunately, he is an English lecturer also. In this nice opportunity, I'd like to share about fun writing. Okay, it was the curriculum vitae of Ms. Nurul Puspita. Okay, for Ms. Nurul, we please you to deliver your explanation.
Well, thank you, moderator, Miss Sylvia. Is my clear voice? My voice is clear, everybody?
Clear?
Yes, very clear.
Okay.
Crystal clear.
Okay, and the slide is short. The slide? How about the slide?
Not yet, wait a moment.
Not yet, okay.
Yes.
Still process. How about now?
Yeah, we can see.
Okay, everybody can see my slide right now. Well, thank you. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
That it's still morning right now. But hopefully it's not the least. But writing always come at last, since the learners or the students should grasp or acquire other English language skills come from listening, speaking, and also reading. And the last one is writing. So in doing the process of writing, the students should acquire those third others English skills before come to writing. And in this lovely occasions, thank you very much for Rumah Baca Madinah for having us in this webinar with our big theme, the extensive language skills, the joy of learning English. Then I simplified it into my title. It's about writing for pleasure. It is about the AI utilization. So during this pandemic situations, all the students of university and also all the students of schools take their online learning, right? So the use of tool in teaching and learning online is very useful. Here, I'd like to show or share you about teaching writing, teaching and learning writing by using EA. So here is some of my example. Is the next slide so everybody? Watch it. Lumia.
Can see now.
Because sorry. This is the menus on my today's presentations. They are about definitions of writing for pleasure. Am I still at this Zoom meeting? Everybody can still?
Yeah, sure.
Yes, it's clear.
Don't worry.
Okay. The second one is about characteristic of writing for pleasure, and then definitions of AI, and then the role of AI in education, and then AI for writing. And the last one is step of AI utilization. Well, this next is come to the definitions of writing for pleasure itself. As we know that many people always know about reading for pleasure, reading for enjoyment, and then they would like to get joy from reading. But in other side, writing also have their pleasure. That is writing for pleasure. That it's about writing for pleasure is volitional act of writing undertaken for enjoyment and satisfaction. So the stress is on enjoyment or and satisfaction. So the stress is on the red one, enjoyment and satisfaction. So the learners or the students in the process of writing will enjoy in doing writing. Every single sentence in their writing. And the kinds of writing is also varied. So apa aja yang mau ditulis itu terserah, bisa letter, CV, many others, essay, even for academic writing itself. And then after doing the process of writing and getting the enjoyment, during the process of writing, they will get their satisfaction. So it is the core in the writing for the characteristic in writing for pleasure itself. For the first one is having a sense of purpose fulfilled, and then they will get what they want to in doing the process of writings. And then ini loh, saya ini pengen menulis apa, misalkan an essay, they'd like to write an essay, then they will get their aims or their goal, then the goal or the aim is fulfilled. So that the characteristic of doing writing is writing for pleasure. And then the second one is the expectations of a reaction and a response. For example, here in the process of writing, the students should write the draft first, and then they will do peer corrections or they will publish. In publishing the writing, of course, they will get a response or reactions for others. For example, in the class, their friends will give comment or suggestions related to the grammar, spelling, punctuations, mechanics, and many more. So if they get what they expect in their writing in the process of publishing, of course, they will satisfy with what they have learned. Jadi dia akan merasa, oh, ada respon ya dari apa yang saya tulis, ada reaction ya dari apa yang saya tulis. Jadi it will get a betterment for the writing. And then the next one is sharing something to be proud of and feeling you have achieved. Jadi dari sharingnya tadi, publishingnya tadi, dia feel that I have get achievement for their self in doing a writing. And then the last one is something significant. Of course, it is the same with those three characteristics that something important in the process of writing that they have achieved or fulfilled. Well, that's the characteristic of the writing for pleasure. And the next one is definitions of AI. Many teachers or lecturers in online learning during this pandemic always use AI. What is actually AI? AI is artificial intelligence. It's like platform of or a digital in online. So everybody can use these tools during teaching online. So the definitions of AI itself is about ability of digital computer or computer to solve problems that are normally associated with higher intellectual processing capabilities or humans. So that for example, here I'll focus on teaching writing. Then I'll prepare some examples of tool in AI so that AI is very important when teaching online is in progressing. But actually, AI like assistant or can help. Jadi apa sih yang bisa kita lakukan as a lecturer or as a teacher in teaching learning online by using AI? That's why. AI like machine or computer control robot. That's the definitions of AI itself. The next one, I'm sorry, it's so far, I think, in move the slide here, is the role of AI in education. Of course, every single factor or every all factors can use AIs, but here I'll focus only the use of AI or the role of AI itself in education, since we are an educator, right? So there are some roles of AIs in education. For the first one is personalized education. Personalized means that we can't, choose by ourselves or based on our needs, so that in personalizing education, for example, Ms. Petra will teach speaking, so they choose some of the tools of AI for teaching speaking, for example, Duolingo, and then Ms. Anunun will teach listening, then they will she will choose some of AI that is appropriate for teaching listening. And this one that AIs in education with personalized you yourself, or the students or the teachers do or do not know before. And then the second one is about the produce smart content. So in AI itself, that will serve like digital lessons. So we'll show the ebook, we'll show other batch size of lessons or textbook, and then study guides and many more. Or the other example is information visualizations like simulation or web pass that is usually used by other lecturers in the use of AI or tools or platform itself. And the last one is as the learning content update. So the contents of your teaching materials can be updated by AI. And then the next one is contribute to task automation. So if we would like to use it suddenly at the time, we can use it automation. And then the next one is do tutoring, like as the what is it, personal study programs, the tutoring will give instructions orally or writtenly in the best web-based or many other apps. And the last one is about to ensure access for students with special needs. So if there is a student with a special needs, we'll listen to the audio AI, some AI will provide for it. Just for example, AI will provide some tool that can be used for the special students itself. And the next one is, here is the example of AI that is usually I've used for my writing class, especially in my academic writing class and also my essay writing class. They are, first is Poplet, and the next one is Hemingway, and then the third one is Outright, and the last one is Potlet. So the first one is Poplet. Poplet is usually used for generating the ideas of is part of the what is a process of writing itself. So the first one, if we would like to produce our essay, we should brainstorm first, activated our students' background knowledge first, so that what they grasp or they can elaborate their ideas or they can generate their ideas. Poplet ini bisa langsung diakses ya di Chrome atau apapun. Jadi tinggal ketik aja poplet.com. Actually it is free, but it just for one examples of the Popple gitu. Jadi ini nanti langsung bisa langsung ke poplet.com-nya, and then you can log in or sign up first for the first round, and then you can make such kinds of diagrams or a mapping. It's based on your needs in brainstorming session. So before doing a drafting in the process of writing, sebelum kita menulis apa sih yang mau kita tulis gitu kan, jadi kita bisa bikin dulu brainstorming diagram firstnya atau mappingnya first. Jadi dari for example the topics, for example writing, so we would like focus on the difficulty of the students writing. Apa aja sih the difficulties of the students difficulties atau students problems gitu. Kita bisa bikin mappingnya seperti itu, atau di sini bisa bikin mappingnya. It's depend on your needs in doing a brainstorming session. Jadi dari students difficulties in writing itu bisa apa aja, limit times. For example, because in the classroom, the time is so limited in doing writing, so bikin terburu-buru jadi nggak konsentrasi, atau the students are less of vocabulary, or the students have difficulty in starting their ideas or in generating the ideas gitu. Kalau tiba-tiba your teacher or your lecturer asks you to okay, menulis ini temanya environmental atau health or many others topic, pasti mereka akan bertanya-tanya fokusnya di apa, thesis statementnya seperti apa, and then main ideanya seperti apa. But in the process of writing, we should do part by part, and then we can use this AI poplet.com in generating the ideas. That's the example. You can search it by yourself, or you can try it for generating the ideas or brainstorming the ideas. This is the steps, yeah, for the first one, that is Poplet here for generating the ideas. And then the second point or the second one is the use of Hemingway or Outright. And just remember, or always remember, the AI or artificial intelligence is our assistant, human assistant. So the human first, then technology. So even though in writing, we should use our ability or our capabilities in doing writing, in generating the ideas, and then in drafting the writing itself, so that this AI utilization is as an assistant to help you in, yeah, just to review. For example, here is for checking the draft, that is Hemingway and Outright. Here is the example. This is the Hemingway. So you can write first your draft. You can write down your draft at Microsoft document, and then you can copy it here and the Hemingway app. This is free also, everybody. So everybody can use it, but remember, it is not Grammarly checker or plagiarism checker, because it is only every applications or every web pass, what is it, reviewer for your writing. So you just give some note, which is noticed by color here. Jadi color ini di sini akan notisin kalian. Oh, kalau tulisan kalian ini kayaknya sentence-nya kurang bagus atau too simply or ada nouns-nya atau kalian perlu apa yang lain, nanti speech readability-nya juga ada di situ. Jadi it's just to review your writing, your unwriting. The next example, it can be outright. This is also the free one, but you need such kinds of sign up first by using your email for the first one. It is quite the same with the use of Hemingway. I just copied my students' work, and then I paste here in this vault, and then I start to know what happened with their spelling, what happened their punctuation, and then what happened their capitalization. This outright will help you to revise in the small one, but actually your ability or your capability as the writers to produce a good writing is very important. Okay. And then the last one I have here, I'm sorry. Here is Padlet. Tadi Miss Nunun udah pakai ya Padlet buat upload video, giving comment or suggestions. Well, I always use this tools, Padlet, in my writing class, because it's very useful for doing peer editing or peer corrections or peer workshops. So I just make such kinds of home in my dashboard, and then I ask all the students to post or to upload their writing here. Then I'll give the peer editing checklist so that they should pay attention to the peer editing checklist. For example, for the content, apa aja sih yang harus dikoreksi dari kontennya, apa sih yang harus dikoreksi dari mekaniknya. I've give the guideline first, then they can do the peer correction. So each student will give a feedback or corrections for others students. Then saya juga harus kasih tulisnya, misalkan Nova dengan Novi, Ainu dengan Ajeng. Jadi itu biar nggak bentrok mereka, misalnya dengan siapa gitu. Jadi although I've prepared the home or the dashboard or the world in the Padlet, jadi tetap in my guidance. Jadi ini sangat sangat membantu sekali in my writing class, especially in doing peer editing class, so that each of students will get their own feedback, then they will do the revisions in or for their writing. So the use of AI is very helpful during this pandemic situations in teaching and learning online. So hopefully by doing teaching learning that's so exhausted and udah lelah banget kayaknya ya online learning, tapi ya ada sedikit harapan buat kita, ada bantuan buat kita untuk bisa melakukannya itu dengan fun, especially in doing writing. Sebenarnya saya sudah sangat lelah sekali dengan harus memelototin kayak gini terus ya, apa draft-draft yang dari kirim secara online gitu kan. Tapi that's why I'll connect the use of AI or the utilizations of artificial intelligence in my essay writing and also my academic writing class. So it's so helpful for me. Jadi untuk other lecturer or other teacher can choose your own needs in the use of AI during teaching and learning online gitu. Jadi itu sih yang bisa saya sharing. Jadi kalau writing, the process, of course we should follow the process of writing itself. Then we can add the use of or the utilizations of AI so that the writing will the students will get enjoyment or enjoyment and then get the satisfied result in their writing by using some AI that is appropriate for each of English skills. Well, thank you very much for everybody. We are sharing for the further informations. You can contact me at the emails nurupuspita@radininternet.ac.id or this is my WhatsApp number. Thank you very much for me. Back to Miss Sylvia as the moderator. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam. Well, thank you, Miss Nurupuspita, for your fascinating explanation. Okay, now we come to question and answer session. For all the participants, if you want to ask, you can raise your hand. Okay, for all the participants, we push you to ask. Ya, kepada peserta dipersilakan untuk bertanya.
Ya, bagi peserta boleh bertanya menggunakan bahasa Indonesia ya. Iya.
Boleh ditulis di chat box kalau ada yang mau bertanya, nggak masalah. Boleh di chat kalau ada yang mau bertanya.
Okay, I would like to give a question for Mr. Said Wijaya. My question is about how to improve our reading comprehension for TOEFL score. Yeah, as we know that TOEFL is very important for us because we can get a scholarship or study abroad using TOEFL, but I think reading is one of the difficult parts of the TOEFL. Yeah? How can we improve our reading ability, Mr.?
Okay, thank you, Mr. Denny, for the questions. And actually, for TOEFL test reading sections, we need to practice a lot by being familiar with the questions, and the skills. If we have like Brahman's Tuval at Warsek, sebentar.
Shopee, sir.
Okay. So jadi kalau misalnya we want to improve our reading comprehension ability, especially for reading section in TOEFL tests, the very basic one is we need to practice a lot about and being familiar with the questions. Jadi kalau misalnya pengen bisa lebih bagus di reading comprehension testnya, cara yang paling efektif adalah dengan practice, dengan latihan, and being familiar with the test questions, dan harus familiar dengan jenis pertanyaan dalam readingnya. So you need to like buy or have Brown's or any other TOEFL practice. Jadi kan biasanya ada buku latihan TOEFL-nya, and each in each book there will be skills to have to answer the questions in TOEFL test. Jadi kalau misalnya di buku latihannya itu biasanya ada tes, ada skillnya. Jadi for example skillnya adalah untuk memahami stated details atau implied details. Jadi untuk mengetahui detail yang dinyatakan dan detail yang tidak dinyatakan dalam dalam teksnya gitu. Nah di situ kan biasanya there will be questions related to that kind of skills. Jadi biasanya ada pertanyaan-pertanyaan yang kaitannya atau yang menanyakan tentang details itu, tentang stated details. Biasanya kalau pertanyaan untuk stated details seperti ini. Pertanyaan untuk misalnya unstated atau implied details caranya seperti ini. Nah, kita harus familiar dengan question form-nya, dengan format pertanyaannya. Nah, jadi kalau misalnya kita sudah familiar dengan format pertanyaannya, jadi kita tahu apa yang perlu kita cari nantinya. Itu adalah cara-cara dasar untuk enhance our reading comprehensions. Ya, jadi apalagi untuk TOEFL test gitu. Jadi kalau misalnya pingin lebih baik reading comprehensions-nya, kita pertama tadi seperti yang I told you adalah kita latihan dulu. Latihan dengan apa? Latihan untuk being familiar with the question form-nya, dengan format pertanyaannya dan skill yang diujikan dalam TOEFL test-nya. Itu sih yang paling basic-nya. Jadi kalau misalnya kita sudah familiar dengan format pertanyaannya, dengan skill-skill yang diujikannya, ketika kita membaca tes readingnya, TOEFL bagian reading section di TOEFL-nya, kita bakal tahu kalau orang kalau pertanyaan seperti ini menanyakan tentang detail misalnya, atau ini menanyakan tentang spesifik detailnya, ini menanyakan tentang inference-nya, ini menanyakan tentang implied atau unstated detailsnya. Nah, kalau misalnya kita sudah paham dengan pertanyaan seperti itu, maka akan mudah untuk menemukan jawabannya. We don't need to read the whole text, but we need to skim saja. Jadi kita nggak perlu baca semuanya, kita scan aja ataupun kita skim aja. If the question asks you about the general idea of the passages, kalau misalnya yang ditanyakan adalah tentang apa ide umum tentang passages-nya, what is the text about, for example, atau what is the best title for the passage. Nah, itu kan menanyakan tentang general ID-nya. Berarti kita harus pakai skimming, for example. Nah, kita harus familiar dengan pertanyaan-pertanyaan dalam TOEFL test untuk reading sections-nya dan skill-skill yang diujikan di reading sections-nya. Kira-kira seperti itu. Mungkin teman-teman yang lainnya ada yang ingin menambahkan, dipersilakan. Miss Fitra, Miss Nunun, atau Miss Nurul, ada yang mau menambahkan?
I think I have same perception with you. I do concur that we have to practice a lot. Every skill needs a practice, or you have to rehearse. If it depends on your effort, yeah. It is also related to Narisa Rahmasari questions in a chat box that. How to manage our worry in speaking practice. I think it is also happens to every English learner. Yeah, you have to manage that. We cannot avoid that problem because this is a common thing that can appear for every learners. However, we need to manage that. We need to control that. How to control that? We have to prepare ourselves with those vocabularies. You have to get used with the nuance and also the language used. And also you have to be familiar with those vocabularies. I do concur with Mr. Said Wijaya said just now that if you want to be master in TOEFL's reading activity, means that you have to practice with the vocabularies and that, because the common vocabularies is really different with the academic one and then the common one or the regular vocabularies. That's why you have to focus on that. It is also similar with speaking, yeah? Because you want to do it in purpose or you want to do it for free, it is also you have to find your goals, you have to set your goals, and then you have to manage yourself. And I do agree with the previous one that we have to know our weakness. You have to figure out the solutions to cope it. At least if you cannot solve those problem, at least you can adjust it. Saya rasa yang paling penting adalah motivasi dan practice seperti itu. Every skill needs that. Gitu. Jadi walaupun kita motivasinya tinggi, your motivation is high, and also your vocabularies or your abilities actually low, it is also cannot run well. So you have to make it balance, both of them. Yeah, this is actually the appropriate way to overcome the anxiety atau kecemasan itu sendiri. Okay, maybe another one if you want to add some suggestions, Miss Nunun or Miss Nurul?
Okay, maybe I want to add a little bit about TOEFL, ya. But tadi sudah dijelaskan oleh Mr. Said tentang bagaimana belajar reading untuk TOEFL. Sama juga dengan listening. Listening for TOEFL itu juga memerlukan practice tersendiri, because we have to be familiar with the questions in listening comprehension. Yeah, there are three sections in listening comprehension. Part A, B, and C, and they have different patterns. For example, when we want to conduct listening comprehension in TOEFL in part one, part A, for example, this is just short, very short dialogue, but sometimes most of the question, most of the point in every question tend to be focus on the second line. Jadi ada beberapa trik yang bisa kita pelajari ketika kita ingin bisa mendapatkan nilai TOEFL score yang tinggi. For example, di part A itu ada speaker A and speaker B. Biasanya jawabannya itu terkandung di dalam speaker yang kedua. Nah, itu salah satu contoh yang harus kita tahu sebelum kita take the TOEFL test. Kemudian, if we listen to some words, for example, biasanya jawaban yang ada di answer sheet, jawabannya adalah jawaban yang bukan similar sound. Jadi hindari sounds yang mirip dengan apa yang diucapkan oleh the speaker. Itu beberapa contoh trik yang bisa dilakukan ketika ingin mengerjakan TOEFL test. Jadi ada beberapa trik sebenarnya. Gitu.
Okay, thank you, Ms. Nunun. And I would like to answer the questions from Hasanul Misbah. Oh, Misbah. Okay, so the question is, can advanced reading possibly be fun? So the fun part is not advanced reading, but the activity. If the advanced reading is the part of intensive reading, advanced reading, the activity in advanced reading class, for example, should be designed to be fun activities, like having games or modifying several strategies or technique in teaching this kind of advanced reading materials. Okay. Jadi kalau misalnya advanced reading bisa fun atau enggak, itu bukan advanced reading-nya, mungkin activities-nya. Ya, jadi activities di apa materi-materinya ataupun itu jenis mata kuliahnya itu mungkin bisa didesain to be a fun enjoyable learning activities in advanced reading class or advanced reading materials. Ya. Jadi kalau advanced reading-nya nggak bisa dibuat fun, tapi mungkin activities-nya. It is greatly possible. Ya, mungkin sekali untuk activities-nya. Ya, tapi kalau misalnya it is part of intensive reading, nanti dengan extensive reading akan beda sedikit concern-nya. Ya, tapi I guess advanced reading is part of intensive reading because students will learn about advanced reading in the classroom context. Jadi mungkin nanti bisa dibuat learning activities-nya yang fun. Itu untuk Miss Bah. Okay. And the next questions will be for Miss Fitra. Izin bertanya, bagaimana cara menghilangkan rasa takut dalam berbicara bahasa Inggris di depan orang lain jika orang tersebut tahu dia belum menguasai bahasa Inggris dengan baik?
I think I have answered those questions, these questions previously. That if you feel afraid or worry to speak because of your lack of the language skill, I think you have to you have known the weakness. It means that you have to cope with problems. You have to rehearse yourself. You have to learn it, and then at least maybe it depends on the person. Yeah, how I overcome this problem. I always think that English is not my language. English is a foreign language. That's why I think it's understandable if I make mistakes. Yeah. So just do your best, I think, and then just keep rehearse, and do not forget that if you feel anxiety all the time, you will not produce the language. Yeah.
Okay, thank you. And next question to Ms. Nurul. How do you respond students with lack of capacity to do peer corrections? From Ms. Bahasanul.
Okay, still from Hasanul Misbah. Thank you for the questions. The important one or the main is in the process of writing itself. So that gimana sih kita bisa tahu the lack of capacity to do the peer correction itself? That through the process of writing as a lecturer or as a teacher, we should guide them from making an outlining until publishing, so that for all the participants before in doing the peer corrections, I've give a checklist or guidance so they can see about the aspects of writing itself, apa aja sih yang harus dikoreksi di situnya. Jadi mereka sudah tahu, for example, for the content, organization, mechanics, and then the grammar itself, ada listnya di situ. Jadi they can learn by themselves. That then they can increase their capability or ability in doing the peer corrections. Jadi ada nih seperti ini. Jangan bisanya cuman nyalahin punya temennya atau nyalahin orang. Paling gampang kan nyalahin orang atau kasih komen aja tanpa ada pengiranya. Nah, itu dia. Yang in doing peer corrections, will train them or practice the students in giving a comment and also suggestion. Jadi nggak cuman, ini salah loh grammarnya, terus dicoret atau dilingkarin saja. Tapi nggak seperti itu. In doing peer correction, the students should read other students' writing, then they will give the suggestion. Kalau misalkan verbnya salah, benernya tuh seperti apa gitu. Jadi itu sudah ada guidance-nya, ada namanya checklist-nya in doing peer corrections. Jadi I did not analyze about the lack of students' capacity in do peer corrections, but their ability in writing, both in writing and also in editing. Jadi kalau mereka bisa tahu kesalahan orang, pasti in process of writing, in drafting, in process of drafting, dia akan realize. Jadi nggak bikin error lagi, tapi dia udah, oh harusnya kalau misalkan saya di dalam essay writing, terus saya narrative essay gitu. Jadi all the tense is on past tense. Jadi nggak ada lagi tuh misalkan mereka salah menggunakan verb, verb di dalam menulis naratif teks tersebut. Jadi seperti itu untuk jadi saya respon ke their ability or their capability in doing their corrections, but how to revise itself, then I analyze their writing gitu. Kayaknya seperti itu, semoga bisa menjawab ke Hasanul Misbah gitu. Nanti yeah, bisa.
Thank you, Miss Nurul. Yeah. Oke, ini untuk Miss Nurul lagi, ada dari Maya Andriani. Di dalam menulis, biasanya kita mengambil opini dari beberapa expert dan kita harus menuliskan namanya untuk menghindari plagiat. Namun ada beberapa kutipan penulis yang diambil dari penulis lain. Oke, beberapa kutipan penulis yang diambil dari penulis lain. Saya ingin bertanya, apakah boleh kita cantumkan nama penulis yang kedua saja, kita harus mencari penulis aslinya. Oke. Jadi kita menuliskan kutipan yang ada di artikel itu tanpa menuliskan kembali penulis asli yang ada di dalam artikelnya. You know what I mean, ya? Yeah. Dan kalau memang boleh, adakah aturan baku bahwa diperbolehkan kita mencantumkan penulis kedua tanpa harus mencantumkan penulis aslinya, berarti di, mengutip dari kutipan lain gitu. Yeah. Oke, okay. Thank you. Itu dari Maya Andriani.
Well, directly go to Maya Andriani. Maya Andriani semester berapa ya? Udah mulai nulis skripsi sepertinya ya, gitu kan. Nah, itu dia adalah kesalahan bukan apa ya? Bukan kesalahan, kebiasaan atau kesukaan mahasiswa itu, Pak. Dia sukanya bukan mengutip dari first source, trusted source at dari orang pertamanya atau dari bukunya, biasanya cuman kayak di tulisan lepas aja di web atau di apa, mendingan masih di jurnal artikel masih mending ya, karena kita bisa, we can see the reference, the list of the reference, and then we can find out the first writer at the books itu siapa. Jadi kita runtutin aja harusnya. Di situ kalau lihat di reference-nya, oh ini dari bukunya ini, kalau bisa kita cari aja bukunya langsung gitu. Dan biasanya sukanya juga kayak menulis kayak di Bunga Rampai. Jadi itu kayak the collections of writing or kayak proceeding gitu kan, dari beberapa kumpulan. Nah itu biasanya cited on cited gitu. Jadi mengutip dalam kutipan gitu. Bagusnya itu ada aturannya. It's depend on your what is it, guidelines in each of the university or institutions. Itu biasanya punya kutipan atau panduan penulisannya masing-masing. Tapi kalau misalkan untuk yang secara umum, biasanya di associations of Philosophical of America atau apa, itu biasa ada tulisannya. Jadi kalau kita menulis dari sebuah, mengutip dari kutipan orang, nah itu ada. Jadi dua-duanya harus disampaikan, harus ditulis. Misalkan Fitrah Aulia Ansar in Sayyid Wijaya atau sebaliknya seperti itu. Jadi nanti di dalam footnote, biasanya it depends ya dengan guideline-nya, itu makanya footnote atau body notes. Kalau body note bisa directly di dalam paragrafnya tersebut langsung disebutin seperti yang Ms. Nurul bilang tadi, Fitrah Aulia Ansar in M. Sayyid Wijaya atau seperti itu. Kalau misalkan itu footnote, biasanya ada di footnote-nya catatan kaki di bawahnya atau nanti di reference-nya. Jadi itu kutipan, mengutip di dalam sebuah kutipan gitu. Jadi kayak Bunga Rampai, proceeding biasanya kayak gitu. Karena mahasiswa itu lebih gampang dan sukanya mencari yang barang yang sudah ada dan kelihatan gitu, tanpa harus apa sih yang harus saya tulis itu difikirkan dulu, saya ini source-nya apa, cari source-nya dulu. Tapi enggak, jadi yang paling benar adalah ketika kayak kita sudah mulai menulis skripsi, topiknya apa, temanya apa, problems-nya apa, kalau baru kita kumpulkan source. Jadi akan menghindari yang seperti itu. Nanti sayang dong, kasihan penulis yang pertamanya itu, masa iya enggak dicantumkan di situ gitu. Jadi it depends on the guidelines of each of the university or institutions. Tapi kalau untuk guideline atau pedoman yang secara umumnya ada di apa gitu for Maya Andriani gitu. Okay, back to siapa ini, Mr. Said atau Sylvia?
Mr. Dani. Okay. Okay, thank you, Ms. Aisa. Sebelumnya, we would like to express our gratitude to Ms. Aisa Sunarwan, Ms. Ning Setiawati, and Ms. Dewi Kurniawati yang sudah setia menunggui kami. Okay. And if there are more questions, silakan boleh ditulis di chat. Oke, silakan ke Pak Denny.
Boleh saya tambahkan? Boleh saya menambahkan?
Oh ya, silakan misalnya untuk menambahkan.
Iya, tadi yang tentang cara menghilangkan rasa takut ya ketika berbicara bahasa Inggris di depan orang lain. Based on my experience when I was university students like you, I was very shy. I'm an introvert person, so it's difficult for me to speak even in bahasa Indonesia in front of people, apalagi kalau banyak orang gitu ya. And what I'm doing at the time is di situ kita membentuk sebuah community of practice COP. So in my university there is ESA ya, di sini ada ESA juga ya. And one division of ESA itu bertugas untuk meningkatkan English skill of their members. Jadi setiap minggu mereka membentuk kelompok-kelompok kecil untuk berlatih speaking. So in that community, it's really helpful for me to build my self-confidence first. Jadi ketika saya sudah mulai tumbuh self-confidence, I can speak I can speak easier in English. Jadi ketika kita bertemu dengan orang-orang yang cocok, ketemu dengan orang-orang yang senasib, sepenanggungan, satu tujuan, satu goal gitu, I think it really helpful for me, for us to practice speaking. Gitu. Dan di community of practice itu kita mempunyai satu mentor, mentornya dari kakak tingkat yang humble dan tidak underestimate, so that's why I was really comfortable in that communities and it's really helpful. Yeah, thank you so much.
And once again, I just wanna emphasize to everyone that there is no measures of enjoyment. I think you have to find your way. If you like reading webtoon, just go on. But again, you have to see your purpose. If you want to expert in TOEFL test or IELTS test, it means that you have to develop your vocabularies, and that's why you have to figure out which one do you prefer. Which one do you prefer first? The comprehension, or you want to learn the language for your own competencies. So you have to find your own way to find the fun you want to explore.
Well, any other questions? Okay, if there is no question anymore, I would like to say thanks to our presenters who have answered all of the questions by the participants. And based on the material that has been shared by the presenters, I can conclude that there are four skills in English, speaking, listening, reading, and writing. All those skills are important to be learned if you want to mastery in English. But due to pandemic era, of course, we take online learning, but that is not obstacle for us to keep learning because we can use the ease of internet. we can use our social media to explore what we need to improve our English. We can use YouTube or watch video on internet to improve our speaking skill by imitating it, or hearing podcasts to improve our listening skill. And you can read book based on your level and find your book appropriate with your speed in reading. Just find your book, just find book that you like, because it will make you easy to understand what you are searching for in reading. And in writing also, we can use applications to enhance the ability of writing. Okay, to close this webinar, let's say alhamdulillah.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you for all the presenters and also the participants for joining our webinar this morning. I do apologize for my mistakes, and dikembalikan kepada Rumah Baca Madinah. Thank you.
Thank you, Sylvia.
Thank you, Sylvia. Okay, thank you, Bapak-bapak dan Ibu-ibu. Now we have a photo session. Yeah, please open your camera. Oke, teman-teman silakan buka kameranya ya. Iya, masih banyak yang belum dibuka kameranya.
Ayo foto-foto kita.
Nah, jangan sambil tiduran ini ya. Masih rebahan, Pak. Iya, saya screenshot ya semuanya, on tersenyum. Oke, cheese. 1, 2, 3, cheese. Oke, next page, pilih. 1, 2, 3, cheese. Yeah.
Terima kasih tim kompak ini.
Thank you.
Terima kasih, Mbak. Apa kabar, Mbak?
Oh, ini satu angkatan ya.
Belajar lagi yuk. Satu angkatan dan satu jiwa.
Sayid, sehat, Yid.
Sehat atau Mbak Isa, gimana kabar?
Alhamdulillah.
Kayaknya bahagia sekali wajahnya, bersinar-sinar.
Saya telat tadi ngikutinnya, nggak dari awal. Oh, sorry, Sayid and tim ya ini ya.
Kedatanganmu tiada kesan tanpa kedatanganmu, kan?
Iya. Salam kenal untuk Bu Fitrah ya.
Salam kenal, Bu.
Iya, Bu.
Salam kenal, Bu Aisyah.
Bu Nurul ya, Bu Nunun ya. Salam kenal dari Aisyah, Bu.
Udah, ya.
Main kesini, kapan ya, Yit?
Ah, males.
Ya, ini alumni itu, Pak Said. Nggak pernah ke kampusnya lagi. Gitu.
Satu. Ini Hasanul Misbah di mana, Hasanul Misbah?
Di sini dia, lagi ini.
Di hatinya.
Jakarta ya?
di kampusku dia.
Oh iya ya. Oh.
Ini ya.
Oh, ini Paul.
Ini Aul. Ada dua Aul. Ini Aul kan.
Sebaranmu, Beb. Mas Al aja lah.
Aduh.
Jangan
Aldebaran. Assalamualaikum.
Waalaikumsalam.
Jamaah. Oh, jamaah.
Nanti kita jadi satu tim lagi, Pak Hasanul.
Tenur.
Firman ini. Oh, iya.
Oke, terima kasih semuanya ya. Acara selanjutnya makan siang. Ya, silakan.
Alhamdulillah. Makasih loh.
Masing-masing ya.
Ada di meja masing-masing tapi.
Ada di meja masing-masing.
Prasmanan.
Terima kasih banyak. Teman-teman di Winril.
Ya, sampai
jumpa
lagi ya.
Terima kasih ya. Bye bye.
Thank you Miss Ai. Salam buat yang lain ya.
Ya, bye bye. Assalamualaikum.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Ya. Awul ke PBI dulu nanti di Ustek dulu, Pak.
Saya ke mana nih? Saya ke mana nih? Wahai manggilnya apa saya ya, biar enak kayak Mas Miss Aul doang gitu, kayak nggak hormat gitu.
Partisipan kalau mau meninggalkan Zoom dipersilakan, kalau mau stay juga nggak masalah. Kalau misalnya ada yang mau ditanyakan lagi di luar konteks juga nggak apa-apa.
Udah jelas kan tadi nipnya.
Kalau misalnya ada yang mau ditanyakan partisipan yang lainnya boleh sih, nggak masalah. Mumpung kita masih di apa Zoom-nya.
Banyak tanya dikit nggak nanti nih?
Nggak dikit kok. Paling nanti disuruh kena denda kan.
Ini kayaknya pada takut nanya nih, presenternya intimidating nih bahasa Inggris ya.
Sama berproses.
Keren, materinya keren, mantap.
Apa? Mana betah di sana, di Dawa?
Waduh, harus bilang betah nih lagi di kantor, masa saya bilang gak betah?
Yang tambah ya.
Eh, Uswatun, mana ini? Kita belum foto bareng Uswatun.
Oh, lagi ada tamu kayaknya.
Selain yang penting sudah diwakili suami lah ya.
Iya, iya, iya. Terima kasih ya Pak, saya dan kawan-kawan yang.
Oke, sami-sami ini kami yang berterima kasih sudah difasilitasi ini.
Belum bisa memberikan apa-apa, ini hanya sertifikat aja.
Ini mah sudah banget gitu kan. Sudah memberikan something. Sudah memberikan sesuatu yang berarti. Nah.
Iya, tadi mohon maaf tadi. Ah, Silvi.
Sudah keluar ya?
Sudah keluar.
Belum foto orang.
Kebanyakan mahasiswa Bapak ya, Pak ya?
Saya nggak punya mahasiswa sih sekarang, jadi bingung besar kemana.
Oh iya, belum selesai ya.
Udah nggak punya grup mahasiswa.
Lanjut, di Malang berarti bareng ini si siapa? Merliani ya?
Anggi panggilannya.
Oh, iya. Yang bareng sama si Anggi satu angkatan kalau nggak salah. Iya kan Mas ya?
Iya, tapi kami
sudah selesai belum?
Spesial Kemenak kami ini.
Yang anak-anak Kemenak biasanya disendirian loh kelasnya.
Iya, waktu iya, semester 2 kan, ya? Aja yang digabung. Semester 1 bisa, semester 3 bisa. Waktu semester 2 doang itu yang digabung. Jadi kenal, tadinya nggak kenal.
Kalau anak-anak Kemenak di mana Pak? Di dekat masjid atau di mana?
Iya.
Suruh ngaji gitu ya.
Sekarang kan di bawah fakultas itunya.
Fakultas bahasa dan sastra. Jadi
pasca sarjana kan nggak ada sekarang di bawah fakultas semua. Yang di bawah fakultas di bawah pasca sarjana ya, itu program PPG.
Berarti tapi gedungnya masih sama kan ya?
Sekarang gedung yang pasca lama itu sekarang jadi Fakultas Psikologi.
Walah, nah berarti ini dekat apa? Dekat Geraha ini ya? Geraha Cakrawala ya?
Iya, pernah kuliah di sana juga jauh banget depan Matos itu ya.
Ah, ya? Kalian lompat tipisnya di mall kan?
Iya, tinggal nyebrang coba.
Iya, beli jajannya di mall, tipis di mall iya. Kan? Anak mall, anak UM kan, anak Malang itu anak-anak mall.
Tinggal nyebrang coba, mall Transmart sama Matos.
Matos kan.
Ada Transmart.
Pokoknya anak apa UM itu anak mall.
Tapi online kan Pak sekarang ya Pak ya?
Iya, online mulai semester 2, semester 3, setahun cuma kuliah satu semester. Ya
Allah. Enak tapi tuh.
Ya. Tapi kurang menikmati inilah fasilitasnya loh, Pak, sama
bayarnya
tetap lah. Dosen-dosennya kan jadi kurang akrab loh, Pak.
Iya, betul-betul.
Enggak ada kedekatan psikologis,
interaksi, iya.
Tapi deket sama UUS terus.
Iya, itu. Kelebihannya itu. Ngekosnya masih, tapi nggak ditempatin. Aduh.
Oh alah, nggak minta setengah harga, biasanya pada minta potongan loh.
Iya, kemarin COVID. Udah didiskon sama bapak kosnya setelah saya bayar. Oh alah. Saya nggak berani minta, tapi mungkin lama-lama bapak kosnya kasihan. Gitu.
Tapi rata-rata pada minta sih anak-anak.
Gak cuma keringanan UKT aja ya.
Ya, kan karena saya nitip bareng. Udah agak tua ya, saya nggak berani minta.
daerah mana kosnya?
Dekat itu jalan, pokoknya tembus Sambarawa itu, apa namanya?
Tembus Sutami. Ya.
Saya sering jalan lewat tembus jalan Sambarawa itu.
Sambarawa.
Belakang kampus ada pintu Doraemon yang masuk kampus itu loh. Biasanya lewat situ. Lewat pagar belakang.
Banyak. Kepala.
Lu macet-macet ya.
Gak kelihatan setengah kepala. Mungkin agak munduran lagi. Nah. Oke. Mau dihitung? Satu. Gimana Pak Dhani, sudah PW posisinya?
Oh, iya.
Ah, ya.
Saya biasanya pemalu jadi sering ngumpet.
Oh, enggak apa-apa. Kalau sama kita jangan malu-malu. Nah, kita yang malu-malu ini nih jadi.
Lama Pak Said, cepat.
Oke. Satu, tangannya. Ini mau L apa dua. Mau ini? Dua. Oke, satu, dua, tiga. Tiga, lagi. Tiga.
Ya.
Oke, okay. Thank you ya Pak Dhani ya. Thank you Rumah Baca. Sudah ya,
makasih Pak.
Next time mungkin butuh bantuan lagi, siapa tahu ya. Okay. Salam buat Bu Suhanya. Sudah mau direpotin juga.
Okay. Ya, ditunggu kolaborasi selanjutnya. Terima kasih.
Boleh. Oke, salam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Kami tutup Zoom-nya ya.
Ya.
Assalamualaikum.